morning, everybody. We especially welcome any visitors we may have with us, and welcome to those watching online. Please stand as we sing our call to worship song, "When I'm Afraid, I Will Trust in You," Psalm 56:3, Thy Word, page 449, one time through.
God, we come to you this morning just grateful for the day you've blessed us with, Lord. We just ask that you bless our time together, Lord. Ask that you be with those who couldn't be with us this morning. Lord, be with the sick. We just ask that your hand be upon them. Lord, be with this nation. Be with our leadership. Be with the church leadership as well, Lord. We give you all the praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Jay had to leave for a moment, so I will attempt to fill in. And probably by the time I get done, he'll be back in the building. Is there any prayer request, anyone? I know we have one, Don Bonebright, and I may not have all the latest information, but still in ICU. Pardon? Well, still in the hospital at any rate, and did suffer a stroke. We don't know to what degree that is, but with Judy just kind of getting past her health problems, and then now this with Don, be sure to keep them both in your prayers. Patty, you have one? And Patty's brother-in-law, Larry Chadwick, has been trying to get into a nursing home, and of course the paperwork comes first, and it's just not going quite as fast as it could. So the prayer here would be that he get in a nursing home. Okay. Okay. And also, your sister-in-law passed away. Yeah, Helen Bowers. So please keep Patty's family in your prayers. Seems like they've had more than their share of misfortune. Back. You know what I think that is, Becky? I think you want us to pray for you because he's going to college. At any rate, Nick will be going to college. Pray for Nick and Mom. Thank you. Anyone else?
Praise.
Praise, we'll take it.
I get to see Hunter more than once a week.
Pardon? Yeah. Well, he just his announcement was he was going to work there.
Correct.
He didn't tell us he had the pleasure of working with you.
Yeah, he's in our department.
Okay.
And I had a successful first week. So thank you all for the prayers and everything.
Okay, any other prayer requests, praises? the rain did slow down a little bit. And for all the mowing I do, I truly appreciated that. That's my praise. Go ahead.
Did any of you know the Fisher family?
Fisher?
Fisher, a very large family. Joy, her name's Fish, passed, and Chris is doing her services tomorrow, Tuesday.
Okay.
And the visitations at the Spurgeons tomorrow.
Okay. Keep the Fisher family in your prayer for the loss of a loved one. And an additional praise, Travis, nice to have you with us today and your family. Anything else? Patty's got it right. Praise that we're all here.
Amen.
Okay. Anything else?
As we prepare our hearts for a time of prayer, let's sing You Are My Hiding Place, 441. We're going to sing it one time through.
Almighty God, we've offered up names this morning, those who've lost loved ones, those whose loved ones are ill. We ask that you be with each of them, be with their families, be with those who cannot be here today because of illnesses. And we also thank you for the praises, the good news that we've heard this morning. As we continue with our service in word and in song, we ask you to continue to be with us and to bless each of us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we prepare our hearts for the body and blood of Jesus Christ, we are going to sing Come Share the Lord All Verses, page 364.
Stranger here. morning. I guess my praise this morning is the fact that my brother-in-law sent me this book about important words of the Bible and the unforgettable story that they tell. I've used it before. I'll probably use it again because I'm not very original. As I was thinking this week about what thoughts I should bring at this point, the thought crossed my mind how we've talked, particularly in the search committee, but also as a church in these past few months, about the Lord's leading and how we don't want to get ahead of him. And we've relied on him, particularly in our search for a senior pastor, to just show us what we need to do and then tell us to do it. So this little reading is called Appointed, Assigned, Provided, or Obtained. And this is from Jonah 1:17. And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the stomach of the fish 3 days and three nights. Did that just happen? Or did the Lord do that? According to the scripture, the Lord appointed it. The Jewish prophet Jonah was told by the very non-deistic God of the Bible to go to Nineveh and tell the Assyrians to repent. Only one problem. Assyria was a godless empire determined to destroy Israel. Not wanting to see his enemies experience God's mercy, Jonah promptly boarded a boat going the opposite direction. We all know the story. This is when God began appointing various things. The Hebrew word for appoint sometimes refers to numbering or counting of something, but can also mean to determine or destine something to assign, provide, or ordain a thing. The book of Jonah says that God sent a storm to get the attention of Jonah, and after the prophet convinced his fellow travelers to toss him in the sea, God appointed a fish to swallow him. 3 days later, when Jonah decided he might be better off obeying after all, the Lord commanded the fish to vomit Jonah out on the dry land. The waterlogged prophet reluctantly carried out his mission, and just as he feared, the Ninevites repented. When Jonah began sulking, God meddled even more in his servant's life. He appointed a plant to grow and give Jonah temporary shade, appointed a worm to come and eat the plant, and then appointed a strong east wind to make Jonah faint. Does all that sound like coincidence to you? God is the opposite of disinterested and distracted. The picture painted in Jonah and throughout the Bible is of a God who's highly engaged. We often speak of coincidence and happenstance. We need to talk more about providence. God is the great orchestrator of life, the ingenious director of human drama in which we all are players. The biblical testimony is that God is intricately involved in the affairs of humanity, coordinating all things to bring about his good purpose. I think we have seen that recently. It's no coincidence that we're here. It's no coincidence that God created the universe. It's no coincidence that at the proper time, when the world needed it most, he sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross to save us from our sins. He also, it's no coincidence that Jesus, on the night before his crucifixion, gathered his disciples together and broke bread and drank wine with them, explaining that this was his body and his blood that was given up for them. Likewise, it was given up for us. Would you pray with me? Father God, we do thank you so much for all you do for us each day. We thank you so much, Lord, for orchestrating our lives, even though we sometimes don't follow your leading. Forgive us when we stray. Be with us as we go throughout this next week, and guide us in your ways that we might better serve you. We ask in Jesus' name. I would explain to you that here at Bologna Christian Church, we have open communion. Anyone who has accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior is welcome to join with us as we go through this ordinance. Partake as you feel led, and this is a time to open your heart to God, receive whatever He might have for you, and to ask His forgiveness for where we've all strayed during the week.
So, today I'll be singing and playing for you, "I'll Fly," or "This World Is Not My Home." Oh, Lord.
about that guitar player? I don't know who he was, but I bet he's got... I bet he's got good parents. Somebody gave me this. I don't know if I need to use it or not. A couple people here probably think I have a big mouth. Thanks for not saying amen on that. I do appreciate the chance to be back here again this morning. Let's open with a prayer, if you will. Father God, it's a privilege for me to be here, and it's a responsibility I don't take lightly, Father, to be called up here right now to give the word to this congregation. Father, I thank you for the privilege and the responsibility. I pray that your spirit be upon me and be upon those who hear this morning, and that what we say and do here, Father, will be pleasing in your sight. It would touch the hearts that need to be touched this morning, and Father, it would step on the toes that need to be stepped on. I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, so at our house, me and the boys and the wife a little bit, we like snakes. We think snakes are just about the most incredible creatures that God ever created. It's a big deal for us if we see one. If we see one out in the yard, we go out and we pick it up and we hold it and we check it out and we all take turns holding it and looking at it. And if we see one in the road, we'll stop and make sure it gets out of the road so it doesn't get run over. We just think they're neat creatures. But my boys understand that there are some snakes in the hills behind our house. I live behind the golf course there. There are some snakes back there that can kill you. I mean, some of you have probably had run-ins with those. I'm sure some of the Hounsfields here, maybe some of you others who have lived in this area have run into the rattlesnakes that live back there. There's some big timber rattlers back there. And a bite from a timber rattlesnake would be a pretty serious situation to somebody like me, and to somebody like one of the little guys there, it could be catastrophic. So they understand there are snakes back there that can kill them. And I guess that's why this sermon today touches my heart so much, because we're going to talk about snakes for a minute. So the scripture reading this morning is out of Numbers chapter 21. If you want to turn there, Numbers chapter 21, will be starting in verse 4 and reading to verse 9. The Bible says, they traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the desert? There's no bread, there's no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, we've sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray the Lord will take the snakes away from us. So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, make a snake and put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live. So Moses made a bronze snake, put it up on a pole. And then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. So this is a kind of a cycle that we see the children of Israel going through. They're going through the desert, and God's leading them into the promised land, and they take some detours because of their lack of faith, and they get to grumbling, and they get to complaining against God, and he sends punishment on them. And after just a little bit of time under God's punishment, they repent, and they say, we're sorry. Take this punishment away. And so this is another instance of that. And in this instance, God sent venomous snakes to bite them, and they were dying. And the people begin to call out to God, please do something about these venomous snakes. We're dying down here. And so God said, okay, Moses, here's what I want you to do. I want you to take a pole, and I want you to make a bronze snake and put it on this pole and put this snake in the camp somewhere. And then when someone's bitten, all they have to do is go look at that snake on the pole, and they'll live. That's all they had to do. If they didn't look at the snake, they would die. Look at the snake and you live. Pretty simple, right? So my question for you is, say you're laying in your tent one night and you hear your child cry out in the next spot over there beside you. And you jump up and you grab your lamp, your lantern, and you run in there. And you look down and you see your child lying there. And you see the snake coiled up there. And you see the fang marks in the leg where the snake has bitten the child. What are you going to do? How many parents in here would look at the snake and look at the child and say, looks like you got bit, son? Maybe we ought to keep an eye on that, see what happens. Let's watch it for 2 or 3 days and see what happens. You know, sometimes snakes do dry bites where they don't even inject venom. Maybe that's what it was. Maybe it's a dry bite. We probably won't even worry about it. Or maybe, you know, there's a lot of different kinds of snakes in this area. Some of them look alike. Maybe that's not even one of those venomous vipers that God sent. Or maybe you'd look at your child and say, buddy, I know you got bit by the snake, and I know death may be coming for you, but you're just so busy. You just got so much going on. When things slow down a little bit in your life, maybe we'll go talk to somebody about this snake bite. Would any parent here have done that? Any reasonable parent? No. How many people would grab that child up in their hands and run through the camp like a maniac saying, where's the snake on the pole? Who's got the snake on the pole? I've got to get my child to that snake. I've got to look at that. He's got to look at that snake, because if he doesn't, he's going to die. I would run through the camp like a wild man with that boy in my arms, and I would say, where's the snake? Where's the pole? And when I found it, I would say, can you see the snake, buddy? Can you see it? Let me open your eyes up. Make sure you get a good look at the snake. Do I need to get closer? Because I know that if I don't get my child to that snake, to look at that snake on that pole, he's going to die. Any rational parent would do that, wouldn't they? Any rational parent who loves their child would make it a point that very moment. You wouldn't wait till the next day. You wouldn't wait a week down the road. You would grab your child right then, and you would run through that camp until you got to that snake on the pole. Now, we understand, like the brother talked about on this morning, there's no coincidences in God with God's planning, is there? It wasn't a coincidence that God didn't just come up with this punishment of snakes and a snake on a pole out of thin air. It wasn't just something he decided on the spur of the moment, I think I'll kill him with snakes and put one on a pole. We understand that this is prophetic of Jesus coming. We understand that God took the very thing in the snake that brought death, and he put it up on a pole in order that we would look at it and we would come to it and find life. And we understand that that was prophetic of Jesus, and that God took the very thing that brings our spiritual death, the sin, and he put it up on Jesus' cross. And we simply have to get to that cross to find spiritual life. We understand that, right? Jesus says in John 3:14, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up too. We knew that. And if you didn't, you do now, right? So my question for you then now is, where is the urgency? Where is the urgency to get, let's keep with our example of the children. Where is the urgency to get our children to the cross? We know. Children, maybe your children, we all know young people who have been bitten. We all have the venom of sin coursing through our bones. So why are we, do we not have the same urgency to get our children to the cross of Jesus Christ? Knowing what's waiting for them if they don't. Knowing what's going to happen to them if we don't get them to that cross. Where's the urgency? Do we look at our kids like we talked about earlier and say, you know, I know you've got a sin problem, buddy, and I know we need to deal with it, but you're just so busy. There's just so much going on in your life right now. You know, school started, and boy, they just packed the homework on them now. My kids come home. He said, Dad, well, I almost had homework on the first day of school. Isn't that crazy? One day of school, first day of homework. And if there's any teachers in here, I don't mean to step on your toes, but I know you're busy, buddy. You got school and you got homework, and then we got ball practice at night, and then we got tournaments all weekend, and you got guitar lessons, and we do taekwondo, and we got dance recital, and you're just so busy. But, you know, after things slow down, maybe we'll go find somebody to talk to about this sin problem. Now, those things are great. I don't mean to take away from all those things that the kids are doing these days. Those are good people. Kids need to be doing these things. But if our kids become the next baseball stars, basketball stars, the next Stevie Ray Vaughan, or the next whatever it is, if our kids become those next things, but we have not instilled a relationship with Jesus Christ in them, then we failed them on the most basic level. We failed them on the most important thing that, as parents and as mentors, that we should be doing for them, and that's putting them in touch with Jesus Christ. That's bringing them to this cross to get this sin problem taken care of. But the truth of the matter is, it's not just our children. You know, I preach at a lot of churches in the community, several churches around. And it doesn't matter what's on the outside of the building, or what songs they sing, or how they portray the song, or how you put the songs up on the screen, or how the pews are set up. They all have one thing in common, and that's empty pews. Now, my wife said, well, maybe that's because they heard you're going to be there that Sunday, but I don't really think that's true, so we'll disregard that. All the churches we go to, all the churches have empty pews somewhere. Why is that? The truth of the matter is, it's because we have lost our compassion and our passion for the lost. We've lost that as believers, if we ever had it. You see, I don't have to go very far out of my immediate family, my wife and my two children. Though they've all accepted Jesus Christ, and they're all in good shape. And I know, hey, if death comes for them today, I know they're in good shape. I know they're going to inherit eternal life with Jesus Christ. And so it's tempting for me to just put a hedge around those three people that mean so much to me and not even worry about the world outside. Hey, we're saved here. We're in good shape. You guys do whatever you want to do. The truth of the matter is, I don't have to go very far outside of my immediate family to find people who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. I don't have to go very far outside my circle of friends, actually inside my circle of friends, to find people who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. I go to work every day. I have work, interact with people who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and I know what's waiting for each and every one of those people if they die outside of Jesus Christ. I know what's waiting for them. Where's the urgency? Remember the story of the rich man and Lazarus? Remember when Jesus told this story about the rich man and he had no relationship, didn't care anything about God, and the poor man Lazarus was laid at his feet and or laid outside his gate and was begging for food, and Lazarus had a relationship with Jesus Christ, apparently, had a relationship with God. And Lazarus went to Abraham's bosom. He went to paradise. What happened to the rich man? The Bible says he went to hell, didn't he? Remember that? Remember what he said? He said, please send somebody up because I've got brothers and I can't stand the thought of my brothers coming to be in this place. You know, there are stories written. I've read a book once and I've seen there are movies out of people who claim to have died for just a few moments and they got a glimpse of heaven. Wouldn't that be great? The Apostle Paul said he done it. Some people say they did it too. I don't know if that's true or not. I hope they did. More power to them if they did. But I would say that a 10-second glimpse of hell would do more for our evangelistic ministries than a 10-minute view into heaven. If we really knew what awaited those loved ones, those people that we love, my family, my friends, if I really got a glimpse and understood what awaited those people when they died outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ, I wouldn't be able to sleep at night. I'd be knocking on their door. 3:00 in the morning. You got to wake up, buddy. I got to talk to you about something. There's something important I want to tell you about. Because I can't stand the thought of you facing judgment, standing in front of God and not having Jesus Christ to take away your sins like we talked about this morning. If we honestly and truly thought about those things, about what awaited people outside who die outside Jesus Christ, it would spur us on, wouldn't it? Every person we know, we would say, hey, do you know Jesus? Every one of our friends, we would be calling them. We say, hey, let's talk about Jesus. You know, when I think about evangelistic ministry, when I think about somebody who has evangelistic heart, I think about the Apostle Paul. Listen to what Paul says in Romans chapter 9, verse 1. I speak the truth in Christ. I'm not lying. My conscience confirms it in the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and anguish in my heart. Listen to this, verse 3. For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, those of my own race, the people of Israel. You understand what Paul's saying there? Paul's saying, I have such love for my fellow Israelites, I have such compassion for these people that I would wish that I could give up, if it's what it took to get them to Christ, I would wish that I would give up my relationship with my Lord. I have such compassion for these people. And look what happens to him in Acts chapter 14. This was probably before he even wrote Romans. He's in the cities of Lystra and Derbe, and he's preaching the gospel to the Israelites, the Israel nation. And he's convincing some of them to come to Christ. But it says in verse 19, some Jews came from Antioch and Iconium, and they won the crowd back over. They stoned Paul, dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead. But after the disciples had gathered around him, he got up and went back into the city the next day. He and Barnabas left for Derbe. Do you know what it meant to be when they stoned somebody back in there? You ever done any research on that, anybody? From what I've read, they would take you to a high place, maybe a high hillside or a high cliff there in the desert, and they would throw you over. And after you landed, they would pick rocks up. Everybody in the crowd would pick rocks up, and they would pummel you down with these rocks. Well, I'm guessing they were aiming for your head, weren't you? And I'm guessing they weren't little tiny, small rocks. I'm guessing they were big rocks, and they were throwing them down. They had anger. They had hatred. They had malice and rage. They wanted Paul to die. The Bible says they thought he was dead. They walked away. We've taken care of Paul. won't hear no more from him. The Bible says, after the disciples gathered around him, he got up. So I don't know. Maybe Paul died right here. Maybe this is where he said he got the vision of heaven from. I don't know. I like to think it was. I like to think Paul got a little pep talk from Jesus right then. Paul, don't give up. Paul, get back in the game. Paul gets back up and he goes back into town. I want you to picture the Apostle Paul walking back into town. His face is probably busted open. His head is bleeding. Eyes swollen shut from these rocks pummeling him. And he walks back into town. And he walks back up and he says, now let me finish telling you about my Jesus. To these people who just throw these rocks at him and just tried to kill him, he still has such compassion for these people. He still wants to bring them into a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's the kind of evangelistic heart that I need. That's the kind of evangelistic heart I want. I don't have that. I don't have that kind of compassion, that kind of love for people. Paul had that. I wish I did. The truth of the matter is, we see people on a regular basis. If you're out in society, if you're out in the world at all, you see people who do not know Jesus Christ. And Jesus calls us to go out and preach the gospel to these people. Take the gospel out, he says. Preach the word to them. It's our responsibility as children of his children to take that gospel out. But the truth of the matter is, we fail. I fail on a regular basis. I was impressed with Lisa here a while back. She had a friend who was caught up in some sin, some bad decisions. And a lot of people were talking about this friend. And it would have been easy to fall into this gossip and have you heard and did you see and did you know? You know what she did? She didn't talk about her behind her back. She went right to this person and said, there's a lot of stuff people talking about you. I want you to know I'm not judging you. I want you to know I'm praying for you and I love you. And even though you've made these mistakes, I still love you and I'm still praying for you. That's how you reach somebody with the gospel. She probably done more for the evangelistic ministry of that person than anybody had ever done for this person in her life. Simply going to him with love and compassion, say, I care about you. I want you to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. I want you back in a good place with Jesus. I care about you. That's the kind of attitude that we need. That's the kind of action that God's calling us to do, to go out and take forward. The truth of the matter is, I guess I'm the other way around. I don't show that kind of compassion to people like I should. Let me close with this story, and we'll get Phil home for his pre-lunch nap here on time. Up at the airport in Seymour, I've got a plane up there, and me and my family, we go up there and we fly. They've got this really nice building at Seymour, and there's some general manager's office is in there, and there's some boardrooms and stuff in there. And in the back of this building, there's a little room, a little 12 by 12 room or something, and this is the pilot's lounge. It's got a couch in there. It's got a television on the wall, desk over here, computers, recliners. And if pilots are flying through or if pilot drops somebody off or if they're waiting on somebody, a passenger, they go in this little room and they hang out. And you can wait on your passenger or you can get on a computer and check the weather. It's a place that are made for the pilots, the transient pilots. And me and my family have used this room several times, go in there to eat lunch or to stop and check the weather and stuff. Well, last year in the wintertime, some guy moved into this office or this pilot lounge. He just moved in. He's from Chicago. He's got a couple of little junk planes in the hangars down there that he says he's working on. But truth of the matter is, he's just using that as a reason to stay in this lounge. And you go in there and you try to use this pilot lounge, and this guy would be laying on the couch. He'd have his shoes kicked off, and he'd have his trash piled up, his Wendy's sacks over here, and his dirty laundry would be over here, and he wasn't real clean. He kind of stunk a little bit, you know. And it was really frustrating because nobody else could use this room because he had taken it over. And my family tried to go use it once, and Lisa called me and said, there's some guy in there. We can't go in there. They were going to go eat lunch or something in there. And it made me mad. I said, who is this guy? Why would he move into this room? And so I went in there. I said, what are you doing? He said, he's a real smaller stature guy, kind of a quiet spoken fellow. He said, well, I'm just staying here. I said, you live here? Well, oh, no, I'm just staying here. He said, in May, I'm going to go back to Chicago. Said, okay. And so I went back in there a few weeks later, and he was still in there. And I said, you still here, huh? Yeah, I'm going to go back to Chicago in May, he said. And I said, okay. And so I called the director of the air board. I said, hey, how are we going to get this bum out of here? He said, well, let's just wait and see if he leaves, and then if he does, then we'll implement a new policy that prohibits that. I said, well, he needs to go. He said, yeah, I understand. I saw him one more time. I went in there, and I needed to use the computer to get on to do some stuff for the weather, and he was still in there, and I said, still here, huh? He said, yeah. I said, well, I got to use this computer in this personal business, so you need to get out. Okay, so he left. First of May, just like he told me, he went back to Chicago. The third week of May, you know what he did? He died. His name was Bruce. Bruce died the third week. And when I was driving down the road with another pilot, when I heard that Bruce had died, the other pilot, you know what he said? He said, boy, I'd like to get a hold of them two old airplanes he had. I think I could make some money on them. Maybe you can. My thought, I got this big knot in my stomach, and my thought was, I should have been nicer to that guy. I should have been nicer to that guy. Every time I saw that guy, I was just filled with anger because he was taking over this room that I thought should have been a public room, and it was, should have been. And I was angry with him, and I never showed any love, any compassion to him. I mean, think about that. I'm supposed to be out here preaching the gospel. I see a guy who's so down on his luck that he's living in a small room in the back of an airport building, and it never once occurred to me to sit down beside him and say, hey, Bruce, what can I help you with? What's going on in your life? What should I do for you? Have you heard about Jesus? Heaven forbid I could have shared Jesus with him. Bruce, has anybody ever talked to you about Jesus? See, I was so full of anger and judgment that all I did was stand in judgment of this guy. Never once thought about showing him any kind of love, any kind of compassion at all. In fact, if somebody would have said, hey, Bruce, you know that guy that comes in here, that tall, goofy guy with a hot wife? That's how most people know me around town, the tall, goofy guy with a hot wife. Did you know that guy's a Christian? Bruce would have said, no, I don't think so. That guy's not very nice to me. Christians are nice. No, Bruce, really, he's an elder to Church of Christ, and he's actually a part-time preacher. Bruce will say, we must be talking about two different people here, because Christians have love. Christians have compassion for people. Christians help people. They talk to people. They're nice to people. That guy never done anything nice for me. In fact, he talked down to me. Isn't that awful? Isn't that horrible? I feel so bad about that. I still lose sleep over to this day. That's been two, three months ago. I never once thought about being nice to this guy. Why was the thought of sharing Jesus with him, why was that not the first thing I thought of when I see somebody down on their luck, living in a back of an airport building, in these grimy clothes? Why did I never once think, hey, Bruce, let me help you, buddy. You need some money? You need a meal? You want me to put you up in a hotel so you can go get a shower? You want a nice meal tonight? Let me come get you for church Sunday morning. No thoughts like that ever crossed my mind. Anger and rage towards this guy was all I ever thought. What if God said, Bruce, you stay right here in this recliner because Travis is coming in that door tonight and he's going to share Jesus with you. I've laid it on his heart to share Jesus with you. Bruce, tonight you're going to hear about Jesus Christ, my son. What if that was a purpose for me coming in that room all those times? Well, Bruce, he didn't get you tonight, but buddy, next time Travis comes in here, he's going to share the Lord with you. He's going to help you. He's going to give you what you need, Bruce. Never did it. Had 3-4 good opportunities at least to do it, and I never once did. I don't know if anybody ever shared the Lord with Bruce. I don't know if anybody ever talked to Bruce about Jesus Christ. I don't know if Bruce accepted Jesus Christ as his personal Savior or not. I don't know if he did. It wasn't because he heard it from me. As I look back through my life, I wonder how many Bruces I've ran into that needed something from me, that needed to hear something from me about Jesus, that needed to hear the gospel from me. And either I was too preoccupied, too busy, or too full of anger or malice, or just didn't care. Let's be honest. Just didn't care. Yeah, you don't have Jesus. Well, let's move on. How many Bruces have I ran into? How many have you ran into? You know, it's easy to stand in judgment. It's easy to fail, isn't it? I think about Bruce a lot. I hope that when he stood before the Lord, I hope that he said, enter in, thou well, good and faithful servant, well done. Because somebody shared the gospel with him. And I hope that when I get to the glory and I'm in the kingdom of God, I hope Bruce is there and I hope I can apologize to him. Bruce, I'm sorry for the way I treated you. I owe you an apology. I hope I can do that. But all is not lost because we have more opportunities. God is putting opportunities in front of us on a regular basis. There are people out there who need to hear the gospel. There are people out there who need to be in these pews right here. And you and I have been called to take that gospel out. So I challenge you this morning. Look for opportunities. Look for Bruce's. Look for people who need to hear the gospel because you have what they need. Each person in here can give a testimony of some kind. Each person in here can share Jesus with somebody. Each person in here can get somebody in these pews so they can come to a relationship with Jesus Christ. Or maybe it's you this morning. Maybe you're the one that doesn't have the relationship with Jesus Christ. Maybe you need to know about him. Because let's be honest, as bad as hell, the Bible talks about hell, that's not our main reason for bringing people to the Lord. The main reason, the main thing that why we want to bring people to Lord Jesus Christ is because of the peace and the joy that we get from our relationship with him. That's our first and foremost reason for bringing people to the Lord, because of that relationship with Jesus Christ and the benefits and the joy and the peace that we get from that. If you don't have that peace, if you don't have that joy, if you don't have the forgiveness of sins, if you've not been washed in the blood this morning, we're going to offer the opportunity for you to come forward while we sing our next song, the invitation song. I invite you to come as we sing.
We thank Travis for a great message this morning, and I think each one of us could have came forward and prayed for forgiveness for an opportunity that we missed. So we're all in the same boat. And you know, you think about rejoicing. It's hard to rejoice by yourself, so we need to take people with us. A party's much more fun when it's not by yourself. So as we close this morning, just close with a time of announcements. Anybody have anything you'd like to share this morning? Okay, again, the food bank, we want to continue to minister to those people in need there. And Sherry's got tubs down here for donations. And so please encourage everybody to use that opportunity to reach out to someone who's down on their luck, the Bruces of the world. Anything else? Cindy?
We're just a month out, September 12th and 13th.
Yeah, this is a good event for everybody. Wayne, when did you go to, how many years have it been since you've been to VBS? As a student. For all of you who have been years and years, I just had my 40-year class reunion, so I know it's been longer than that since I went to VBS. But we will be having VBS one-day event, and it is for everybody, and especially including grandparents, so you can go back and see how things have changed over the years from how you went to VBS and how the kids learn today.
We won't put you in age groups.
That's a great, great thing. Okay, I have one final quick announcement that I'd like to make. Hopefully, everyone's seen in the bulletin today. And also, if you didn't get one, make sure you get the second handout that's out there. Wayne mentioned this earlier, and last week I mentioned it, as the search committee has worked over the last year. There is a whole explanation of all of the prayers that God has answered along the way. With that in mind, the latest prayer that the search committee had brought forward and unanimously agreed by the elders is that on August the 22nd, a man by the name of J.D. Hopkins, who was here a couple weeks ago and shared a message with us, we are going to propose him as a candidate for our minister position here. Now, there's a lot of things about that that are explained in here, but one of the things you need to know is that the world today is changing, and just because JD is being proposed to come forward does not mean that it will be in a traditional ministerial role. We will still, because of the feedback that we have had, we will continue to utilize a lot of guest speakers such as Travis. So Travis, if you read this bulletin today, don't think that you're getting off the hook, buddy. But as we have investigated other churches and things, we thought we were being pioneers in the activity. We're coming to find out that a lot of churches are seeing a lot of value from having different speakers each week in the pulpit. People like Travis who aren't afraid to come here. We don't sign his paycheck, so he don't care if he steps on our toes or not, right? So that will be part of this new thing going forward. On August the 21st, we will be having a, for lack of a better word, a meet and greet. JD will be down in the fellowship hall. You can ask him anything you want to. He's open to that. If you want to give me questions ahead of time, I'll kind of facilitate that. Then he will be here on the 22nd to do a trial sermon. And then after that, we'll be having a congregational vote at that time. But that's the announcement from the search committee. Any other announcements before we close in prayer in our closing course? My hearing aids aren't in.
Here, I'll come up here today.
Okay, you come right on up here, buddy.
For those online, if you have questions for JD, we're also going to live stream that on the 21st. So if you guys have any questions, just leave a comment, and I'll relay your question to JD.
All right. Thank you, brother. Okay, if you would, please bow with me for closing prayer. Father, we come to you this morning and just all of how you present the right message at the right time for each one of us. Father, we know that your words have been spoken today and your challenge has been laid out before us. So we just pray that as we leave here today, that we see those opportunities that you put before us to share the gospel with those around us. So, Father, this is our prayer in your name. Amen. Our closing song, the doxology, number 66.